हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम बैक टू माय चैनल। सो वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट अ न्यू यूनिट, दैट इज़ स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी। सो ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ पोल आई हैव फाउंड दैट मोस्ट ऑफ यू वांट स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी। सो फर्स्ट वी विल कवर स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी एंड देन वी विल मूव ऑन टू फिजिकल केमिस्ट्री। एंड इन द स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी आई विल कवर बोथ फिजिकल एज वेल एज ऑर्गेनिक पार्ट, राइट? सो फर्स्ट वी विल टेक रोटेशनल और माइक्रोवेव स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी। तो सो you all know in the region of EMR that we use different type of waves, that is radio wave is used for the study of NMR or NQR and NQR. Then we have microwaves. Microwaves are used in rotational spectroscopy and microwave spectroscopy. Then we have infrared. Infrared is used for vibrational spectroscopy. Then we have visible. Visible is used for Raman and electronic spectroscopy. Then UV. UV is used for basically electronic spectroscopy for organic molecules and with unsaturation. Then we have X-ray. X-ray is used in XRD, X-ray diffraction spectroscopy. Then we have gamma rays. And gamma rays are used for MOSBOR, right? And this order is according to the increase in the wavelength. If we are going from right to left, that is, it has highest wavelength. And if we go from left to right, frequency will increase, right? So this is the order of energy, and this is very basic concept but very useful as well. And we all know that different type of energies according to Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation are quantized. That is why we can use them in the spectroscopy. Like electronic energy is quantized, vibrational, rotational energies and are all quantized in nature, but translational energy is not quantized. That is why translational energy is not used for spectroscopy study, right? So these all are the basic thing about the electromagnetic radiations. Then first we are going to take here microwave spectroscopy, or you can call it as rotational spectroscopy. So we are going to use microwaves for this purpose, right? And the wavelength range of microwave is 0.1 centimeter to 13 centimeter is used for this purpose, right? And this spectroscopy is used for gaseous molecules, mainly for liquid and for solids. It cannot be used because they are not free to show rotational motion, right? Rotational motion, if we consider a molecule in three-dimensional way, then it can have three type of moment of inertia, right? Moment of inertia generates after its rotation, right? So we can consider that it has three moment of inertia in x, y, z direction. And on the basis of these moment of inertia, their values, we can classify molecules into different categories. So first type of molecules are linear molecules. Then we will have symmetric top. Third one is spherical top. And the last one is asymmetric top. So we will go in a detail how we can determine that which type of molecule we have. So first one is linear. As the name suggests, linear means we have this type of molecule, right? You can consider it like a OCS. This is a linear molecule in nature. So according to this, it has three moment of inertia. One lies along the bond axis, one will lie in the plane perpendicular, and one will lie perpendicular and will rotate it in the plane. This one, when we will rotate this molecule through this axis, it will move out of the plane. Out of the plane means you can consider that it will rotate, that you can consider that this molecule will come out of the paper, out of the your screen. It will rotate like this, and when you will rotate it by this axis, it will rotate like this, and when you will rotate it by this axis along the board axis, it will rotate in very it will have very small moment of inertia. Moment of inertia means I is given by mu r square, right? Mu is the reduced mass, or you can consider it like that. If I have two atoms here, then it will become m1 m2 upon m1 plus m2, and this r will become your effective length of rotation. So when you will rotate it by this axis, suppose I will call it as ia, this is the moment of inertia along the bond axis, then the r will become very small in nature because we don't have any atom present here. All the atoms lying in the bond axis. So you can call it as that I is nearly equal to zero for it, right? Because r is almost zero. So and this moment of inertia along this axis is suppose ic, and this one is ib, right? So this ib and ic will become equal because for both of them the distance of this atom to this distance of this atom from the center of gravity is same for both of them, right? So r is same for both of them, so ib will become equal to ic and ia is equal to almost zero. So this is the case for linear type of molecules, right? So you can have different linear molecules like CO2, CO, OCS, this one, right? But CO2 will not show your microwave spectroscopy. It is linear in nature, but it will not show because it doesn't have any permanent dipole moment. And this is also a very important criteria. We will discuss it later, that what is a selection rule, how we can determine that which molecule will show microwave spectroscopy, microwave spectrum or not, right? So this is about linear molecule. Then we have second one, that is symmetric top. In symmetric top, suppose I have an example of CH3F, so I can write down this molecule like this, and this axis, this one is your bond axis. This is the principal axis of rotation also, right? So I will denote it by IA, right? When I will rotate it through this, it will become IA. Second one is, which suppose this is the center of gravity for this molecule, and other two moment of inertia will lie like this, perpendicular to each other, and this one is suppose IB and this one is IC. Now for this case, because we have two hydrogen atoms present here, and when we will rotate this molecule, the effective R will be there, right? So we have a value of R here to be placed. In comparison to linear molecules, we have these two atoms placed here. So it has value of IA. It is not equal to zero. So we can say the first thing, that IA is not equal to zero for this case. Then we have IB and IC. So for IB and IC, both will have effective value of R same. Both of them will have same value. It means IB will become equal to IC, right? So we have a general type of formula here, that IB is equals to IC, but it is not equal to IA. It is different, right? Because its effective R is different than these two. So we have this type of general formula, and this IA is not equal to zero. So on the basis of it, we can classify these symmetric top molecules into two categories. First one is your prolate type molecules, and second one is oblate. Prolate means you will have a structure which is similar to a top, this one. When you will rotate this molecule by this principal rotational axis, then it will behave like a top. You have seen top, right? So when you will rotate it, it will behave like a top. It is called as your prolate structure. And these type of the molecules having C and V point group will most of the time will show this prolate type structure. Example are ammonia, PCl3, CHCl3 CH3Cl, right? And for oblate, oblate means you will have structure like this. Suppose this is your central molecule. One atom will lie here, one will lie here, one will lie here, right? So you can easily recognize that this is the structure of BF3. So most common example of oblate type of molecule is BF3. They have D NH point group, right? In addition to it, one the most important criteria to classify the molecules into prolate and oblate is, for prolate, the value of IA, this one, IA is less than IB and IC. Means for it we will have formula like this. And for oblate, this IA is greater than IB and IC. So on the basis we have seen that this IA is not equal to IB and IC, but if it is IA, it is less than IB and IC, it will become prolate, and if it is greater than IB and IC, it will become oblate type structure. So this is the basic difference between these two. Other examples of oblate type molecules are benzene, XeF4, PCl5, staggered and eclipsed ethane, right? Then for prolate, this one is for only prolate, right? Other things are here written for oblate molecules. Another important example of this prolate molecule is allene, right? This is very very important example, and the one question from NET June 2018 came from this topic, that they have given you four molecules and asked which molecule is symmetric top type molecule. So the most famous type of example for symmetric top molecule is allene, right? So correct answer will be allene. Then we have spherical top molecules. For spherical top molecules, IA, IB and IC all will become equal, but they are not equal to zero. Both all the three moment of inertias are equal in all three directions, but their value is not equal to zero. But most of the molecules lies in spherical top category are microwave inactive, like you have CH4. The net moment, net dipole moment for CH4 is zero. That is why it is microwave inactive in nature. Other examples of this category is SF4, SiH4, SF6, CCl4, right? Then we have last category, that is asymmetric top molecules. As the name defines, that all the moment of inertia will not be equal to each other. They all are different in nature. Most common example is H2O, SO2, HOCl, SOCl2, formaldehyde, acetaldehyde, right? So this is all about your linear symmetric top, spherical top and asymmetric top type molecules. Then we will move to the very basic concept. We all know about it, that what is rigid rotator. So we will mainly focus on the important points here. What important formulas are useful for us? Means according to the ideal condition, suppose we have this molecule and if I am rotating it like this, so when it will rotate like this, after rotations, several rotations, the distance from this atom to center of gravity will not change, it will remain as such. This is the ideal condition, but actually this is not so. The distance changes due to centrifugal force. So we will take that one in the non-rigid rotator category. First we will take the rigid rotator, which is our ideal condition. Means bonds are rigid in nature, they are not flexible, they are completely rigid in nature. So there is a complete derivation how we can have different type of formulas. You can consult for that when will. So I will directly write down the formulas which are useful for us. I will not go in the derivation. So the most important formula is for energy of this rigid rotator. The most important formula is for energy, that is h square upon 8 pi square I j j plus 1. And this energy is in joule. This is very important. This energy is in joule. And this j value can have values 0, 1, 2 and so on. Right, it can have zero value also. The next important formula and the most useful, you can say, when we will express energy in the terms of centimeter inverse. So how we can reach to that formula? That E is, we know that energy is equals to h nu, Planck's constant and frequency. We can write down it like this, hc over lambda, and 1 upon lambda is equals to wave number. So this will become hc nu bar. So you can calculate the value of wave number from it, that if I will divide energy by hc, then I will get the value in the terms of centimeter inverse, which is also a way of representation of energy in microwave spectroscopy. So if I will divide this value of E, this whole formula, by hc, then I will get the energy in terms of epsilon, which is also called as the energy in terms of centimeter inverse, which is nothing but similar to our wave number. So it will become E over hc, or you can write down h over 8 pi square ic j j plus 1. So when you will calculate the value of energy in terms of epsilon, then you will place the value of h here, 6.6 10 to the power minus 34, j values. I is calculated using I is equals to mu r square. This is the mu will be given. Mu if not given, then they can give you the molecule like HCl. So you can calculate the value of reduced mass for HCl easily. How? That mu is equals to m1 m2 upon m1 plus m2, right? So you will have to place the value of masses here. H will have 1, and for Cl it will become 35.5 divided by 36.5. So you have to multiply here with 1.6 10 to the power minus 27 for hydrogen, and then similarly for chlorine also, right? And this is in kgs. Then again you have to divide it by this one, because I have to consider the masses of hydrogen as well as chlorine in kgs. So when I will multiply 1 by this and 35.5 by this, I can take the common value, this one, right? So you can calculate the value of mu from here, and value of r will be given in the question. Or if it is given in angstrom, you have to convert it into meters. We will take questions based on it, then it will be clear. Then value of r will be converted, you have to convert it into meter, right? So you can calculate the value of r I, it will become in the unit of kg meter square, right? Then you will have to calculate the value of, you will have to place the value of c here. And you will place the value of C in terms of centimeter. It is 3 into 10 to the power 10 centimeter per second. Why we are placing it into centimeter? Because we have to calculate this value in terms of centimeter inverse. Right. So we will not convert it into meters. And this H will have unit in the joule second. So in this way, you can solve your question based on energy. So next way of representation of this energy is, we can write down it bj j plus 1. B is rotational constant, right? And now from this formula you can calculate the value of B. It is h upon 8 pi square I c, right? You can calculate the value of B from here. Then question comes about the selection rule for microwave spectroscopy. Selection rule, first rule is the molecule should have permanent dipole moment. Second one is the change in the value of j should be plus minus 1, right? Means from 0 to 1 transition is allowed, 1 to 2 is allowed, टू टू थ्री इज अलाउड, बट जीरो टू टू इज नॉट अलाउड. प्लस मीन्स एब्जॉर्प्शन, माइनस मीन्स एमिशन. मीन्स वन टू जीरो इज एमिशन, टू टू वन इज एमिशन. दीज आर ऑल्सो अलाउड इन नेचर. सो दिस इज द बेसिक सिलेक्शन रूल. देन वी विल कैलकुलेट ट्रांजिशन फ्रॉम वन टू अनदर लेवल. वॉट विल बी द वैल्यू फॉर दैट? सपोज आई एम टेकिंग ई जे फॉर अ वैल्यू ऑफ जे एनर्जी लेवल, बी जे जे प्लस वन. सपोज आई एम ट्रांसफरिंग फ्रॉम जे रोटेशनल लेवल टू जे प्लस वन, राइट? सो वी हैव टू कैलकुलेट एप्साइलन फॉर जे प्लस वन लेवल. इट विल बिकम बी जे जे प्लस वन, जे प्लस वन प्लस वन, राइट? इट विल बिकम बी जे प्लस वन जे प्लस टू. एंड देन आई वॉन्ट टू फाइंड आउट द डिफरेंस बिटवीन दीज टू एनर्जी लेवल्स. सो इट विल बिकम इक्वल टू ई जे प्लस वन माइनस ई जे. सो यू कैन कैलकुलेट दिस वैल्यू फ्रॉम हेयर एंड इट विल कम आउट टू बी जे प्लस वन इन सेंटीमीटर इनवर्स. सो यू कैन डायरेक्टली रिमेंबर दिस फॉर्मूला और यू कैन कैलकुलेट बाय दिस वे. Easier way to remember this, because in examination you don't have much time to calculate formulas, so you can remember this one and it is very simple also. So from this we can calculate the value of the, we can draw a graph for the transition from different J values, right? So suppose we are starting from J is equals to 0. For J is equals to 0, the value of energy will become zero. This is called your zero point energy. Then for next level, that is for J is equals to 1, it will become 2B, right? For J is equal to 2, it will become 2 plus 1, that is 3, 3 into 2, 6, it will become 6B. For J is equals to 3, it will become 12B, right? So you can see that the gap between these energy levels is not equal. This one is 2B, this transition for this it is 4B, and this for this one it is 6B. So these are different absorption lines from 0 to 1, 1 to 2, 2 to 3. And if you draw the spectra for these lines like this one, so this is for 2B, this one, this you can call it as first bend. From 0 to 1 it will become your first bend. For second bend you will have to transfer from J is equals to 1 to 2, so you will have a second spectra at energy level equals to 4B. The energy for the second spectra will be 4B, because energy is equal to the difference between these two levels, so it will have energy equal to 4B. And for third transition you will have energy equal to 6B. So these are different spectral lines you will get. You can draw other lines as well. Then you can calculate the value difference in the energy between different spectral lines. So this energy is equal to 2B for all the spectral lines. This energy gap is similar. This energy gap is the gap between different, or you can say consecutive, spectral lines. This gap is not between two energy levels. This is between the consecutive spectral lines, or you can say the gap between consecutive bands. And this gap is constant. This gap is 2B. This is very, very, very important, that this gap is constant, but this gap, the energy gap between different rotational levels, is rising. It is increasing. The gap is increasing, but the gap between the spectral lines or the energy bands you will get will be constant in nature. This is for rigid rotator. And the degeneracy for this energy can be calculated. is g is equals to 2j plus 1. This is the value of degeneracy, right? Then they can ask you different type of questions that they can give you to calculate the value of 2b. That is the they can ask you the how well calculate the value of rotational constant. They will give you the difference between difference of energy between two spectral lines or two rotational bands. They can they will give you this value, and you will have to understand this value is equals to 2b. And now from this, suppose they will give you the value of energy gap between two rotational bands is suppose is 4 centimeter inverse, and then they will give you to calculate the value of rotational constant. So b will become equal to 2 centimeter inverse, right? Then next type of question can be that calculate the energy of suppose first rotational level. First rotational level energy, they are talking about the calculation of energy. So you have to apply this formula. They are not talking about the energy gap or the spectral lines, rotational line. They are just asking that what is the energy of first rotational level. So you have to place the value of j here, that is 1 plus 1, it will become equal to 2b, right? So this will be the value of first rotational level. Similarly, they can ask you the energy of second rotational level, third rotational level. So this can be another type of question. Third type of question is that the position of third rotational line. Suppose they will call they will ask that calculate the or find out the position of third rotational line. So third rotational lines means you have to find out the position of third spectral line. This one means from 0 to 1 transition will give you first rotational band, from 1 to 2 will give you second rotational band, and from second to third will give you third rotational band. So you have to calculate the value of 6b directly, because this energy from suppose this is 0, and from 0 to 6b energy is this will be the value of third position of energy, not energy, position of, this will be the position of third rotational band, right? In the same way they can ask the position of first rotational band, second rotational band, and so on. So this is the type of question. Then next topic is effect of isotope. If different type of isotopes are used, that what will be the effect on microwave spectrum. So we have to just remember the value of energy. Ej is equals to Bj, j plus 1, right? So energy is directly proportional to B, and B we know is equals to H upon 8 pi square Ic. This is the value of B, right? It means B is inversely proportional to I, and I is equals to mu r square. Mu is reduced mass, and R is assumed to be same when we are talking about isotopes. Suppose I am taking the example of HCl and DCl. So it is assumed the value of R between H and Cl is similar to between the D and Cl. It is assumed that the value of R is same when we are using isotopes. So R will remain unchanged. It means it is inversely proportional to mu. So we have to simply calculate the value of reduced mass using different values of masses of H and D. C is same for both of them. The H and deuterium masses will be used, then we can calculate the value of energy. So this one is very simple. Then we will take non-rigid rotator. We have seen that in case of rigid rotator, the bond length is fixed. There is no change in the bond. They are fixed in nature. They are not flexible in nature. But in actual condition, for actual bonds, this is not possible. The bonds are elastic in nature, and they can be distorted when we will rotate a molecule. Suppose I am rotating a molecule. We are talking about diatomic molecules. So when I will rotate it, there will be centrifugal force. this is your centrifugal force, it will works also and it will try to it will act in this direction, means it will try to stretch your molecule. So the bond length will become different, the molecule will become distorted in nature. So as the value of R increases because of the centrifugal force, I will also increase. I is equals to mu R square. So when the value of R will change, I will also change, and when the value of I change, B will also change, then energy will also change, right? So we have to consider all these factors, all these correction factors when we are calculating the value of B and epsilon for non-rigid rotators. Correction factors means we have to consider the change in the value of R during the rotation. Due to the centrifugal forces, there is distortion, and we have to include that factors, and that factors are called as correction factors, and this correction factor is called as centrifugal distortion factor, right? And it is denoted by D. The value of D is equals to 4b cube upon nu bar square, right? We know that B is equal to h upon 8 pi square ic, and this wave number is equal to 1 upon 2 pi c under root of k over mu, right? In centimeter inverse. This is also in centimeter inverse, right? So from this you can calculate the value of D. If the value of B is given or these things are given, I is given suppose, then you can calculate the value of D for a particular type of non-rigid rotator. The formula is also given in Benville, that a difficult type of formula, but I would suggest that you can simply remember this one, and then you know how to calculate the value of B using this formula and the value of nu bar. Then you can simply put all these in this formula and you can calculate the value of D, right? Then the energy value of non-rigid rotators are given by a different formula, that is epsilon. This one, this part is similar to previous one, bj, j plus 1, then we have to minus dj square, j plus 1 whole square centimeter inverse. This is the formula for non-rigid rotator, right? And the selection rule is similar, that it should have a permanent dipole moment. Then selection rule will be change in value of J plus minus 1. Then the energy gap between two energy levels is given by, for rigid rotator we have used this one 2B J plus 1. Now we have subtract 4D J plus 1 whole cube centimeter inverse, right? This is the value of energy gap between two energy levels. Now one thing is very interesting here, that as we increase the value of J value will increase, suppose, means we are going in the higher energy, higher rotational energy level. So when the value of J increase, rotation of molecule will increase, right? It is moving in higher energy level, its rotation speed, it rotates with a faster speed, right? And when it will rotate with faster speed, the distortion due to centrifugal distortion will increase, right? Means a molecule, suppose, rotating with very fast speed, so this force will also increase and this centrifugal distortion will increase, and the atoms will move apart, they will move apart from each other. So the value of R will increase, I will increase, and when I will increase, the value of B will decrease, because B is equals to h over 8 pi square ic. B is inversely proportional to I. So the value of B will also decrease in nature. So for non-rigid rotator, the energy levels will come closer to each other than the rigid rotator. Means, suppose this is for rigid rotator 0, this gap is, first gap is 2b, second gap is 4B, then we have 6B, and then it is suppose 12B. This is the gap in this way. And if I am using non-rigid rotator, then this value will come slightly down, because you can understand that the value of B is decreasing, as well as this negative factor. This negative factor is also increasing. J value increases, distortion increases. So this negative value also increases. So these levels will come downwards as well as closer to each other. So this is the basic difference between rigid and non-rigid rotator. So using this formula, you can calculate the energy gap for non-rigid rotator, and this is the value of energy. So in the question, they will give you the value of D, and if they will not give, they will give you the value of this one, right? I. You can calculate the value of B from here, and you can calculate the value of mu bar using all these terms, right? So this is for non-rigid rotator. Then next important point is intensity of rotational lines. Intensity of rotational spectrum, right? So this spectrum, this intensity depends upon two factors. First is Boltzmann population, and second factor is degeneracy. So the Boltzmann population is given by nj upon n naught is equal to e to the power minus del e over kt. Right, so now you can place the value of E here. This E is the energy in joule, right? So Nj will become equal to Nj upon N naught is equals to E to the power minus Bj j plus 1 upon kt, and because this is in joule, so we have to multiply with Hc, right? So this is the value for Boltzmann population. So if they given you a graph, they give you a graph between Boltzmann population, that is Nj over N naught, and the value of J, because this is exponential curve, so you will get a curve like this. Suppose they have given you two curves like this, and the value of B for this curve is B, and value for this curve, the rotational constant, is B dash, suppose. And they are asking you compare the value of this B and B dash. So you can easily recognize that because this exponential is negative in terms of this B, so the value of B will be greater than B dash, right? So this type of question can come. Then next point is degeneracy. So degeneracy is equals to j 2j plus 1. So the relative population on which your intensity will depend, the relative population is equal to degeneracy, that is 2j plus 1, and the value of this Boltzmann constant, that is e to the power minus bj j plus 1 hc over kt, right? This will be the value. Then if they will plot a graph between relative population and J, the graph comes like this. Means the relative population is highest at a particular J value. This is called as J max. And for this J max, because the relative population is highest, that is why intensity for this transition from this level will be highest, right? And you can calculate the value of J max using this formula, under root of kt over 2bhc minus 1 by 2. This is the formula for J max when you will get the highest intensity rotational spectrum, right? Next type of discussion on this topic can be rotational vibrational spectrum, but we will take that topic after vibrational spectrum, right? Then next is the question from GATE 2018 and 20. So the first question is, the spacing between two adjacent lines of microwave spectrum of HCl is this one. given that the bond length of DHCl is 5% greater than that of HCl, the corresponding spacing for DCl will be. So the question is very simple, that they have given us the spacing between two adjacent line, means 2B is given. I have told you that suppose these are spectral lines, so the gap between these spectral lines is always constant. So this value of 2B is given. This is 6.35 10 to the power 11 hertz, and the B is equal to H over 8 pi square IC. So the value of H, pi and C is constant. So B is inversely proportional to I, right? And it is given that the bond length of DCl is 5% greater than that of HCl. For isotopic studies, we consider most of the time that there is no change in bond length. But in this particular question, they have given us that the value of RBCl, suppose, is 5% greater than RH, right? So the net value will be this one. So you can place this value in the formula of I, and the value of mu can be calculated using this formula. You have to just place the value of H and Cl here, similarly HCl, for calculation of mu HCl, and for mu DCl you have to place the value of MD and MC over MD plus MC, right? So using the value of mu and the R, you can calculate the value of I, and from this you can calculate the value of B, and then the corresponding spacing for DCl, means 2B for DCl, is asked. So you can easily calculate this part. This is very simple. The next question is from GATE 2020. The frequency for pure rotational lines in the spectrum of NO due to change in the quantum number from J is equals to 1 to J is equals to 2 is, right? They are asking us the energy in terms of centimeter inverse, basically. So they are asking us this epsilon E, change in epsilon J is equals to 2B J plus 1. So pure rotational lines from J1 to J, this is J is equals to 0, this is 1, this is 2. So the transition from 1 to 2 is asked. So we have to place the value J is equals to 1 here. This is your 4B. Now you can calculate the value of B using, this is given, H is given, 8 pi square value you know, I, C. So the value of I can be calculated, mu r square, and this moment of inertia is also given. So you don't have to calculate the value of reduced mass and r, you just have to calculate, place the value of I here. So it is all very easy, right? So you can calculate the value of 4b from here. So you can place the value of h here, 6.6 10 to the power minus 34. I'm just rounding off. You can place the complete value, and then add 8 into 3.14 whole square into I value is given, that is 1.6427 10 to the power minus 46, and C is given in meter per second, but we have to calculate the energy in terms of centimeter inverse. So you can directly place the value of C in centimeter per second or in meter per second. Then you, after calculation, you can convert the meter inverse value into centimeter inverse. But I preferentially place the value of C in terms of centimeter per second. So you will directly get the value in terms of centimeter inverse, because all these units will cut each other, only the centimeter inverse will be left, right? So when you will calculate all this, you will get value near 6.8 centimeter inverse, and this is your correct answer. So that's it all about this chapter. I have covered all the important topics about rotational and microwave spectrum. You can memorize the examples of different type of molecules, symmetric top, spherical top, asymmetric top, and linear is very obvious. Then these all general formulas are very useful. Then we will, in next video, we will cover vibrational spectroscopy, physical part, and then we will come to the organic part. Right, so I will finish today's video here. Thank you so much for watching, and if you like my videos, please share my videos with your friends. Thank you so much.